Hi there everybody, Mr. Wilson here again to go through part 3 of the AQA GCSE Further Maths. This is sample paper 1. So when they release the specification for GCSE Further Maths, this is the kind of paper they released with that, the sample paper, to give people an idea about what type of questions they could ask in this qualification. So in the previous two parts, we got up to question 9. So we're going to start on question 10, because I wanted to dedicate quite a lot of time to this question because it is worth 5 marks. And I thought, it's going to take a bit more working out than questions that are worth less marks. So let's jump straight into it then. F of x is equal to 9x over 2 all to the power of negative 1. And g of x is equal to the square root of 1 take px cubed, where p is a constant. Given that f of a third is equal to g of a third, work out the value of p. Well, first things first, if you have this notation here where you've got a sort of a number inside f of x, what they've done is they've said, okay, we've subbed in when x is equal to a third. So they've just subbed in when x is equal to a third into f. So f of a third is equal to, I'm going to put big brackets here, 9 times a third all over 2 to the power of a negative 1. All I've done is replace the x in f of x with a third. That's all I've done. Now, 9 times a third is 3. So this is the same as 3 over 2 to the power of negative 1. Now, anything to the power of negative 1 just means to take the reciprocal of. So we basically just flip this fraction over and we get 2 thirds, like that. Okay, so f of 1 third is 2 thirds. Okay, what about g of a third then? Well, obviously we want to work out what p is, we don't know what that is, but we can sub in a third for in replacement of that x there. So we can say that g of a third is equal to the square root of 1 take away p times 1 third cubed. And we can just sort of tidy this up a little bit, because 1 third cubed means a third times a third times a third. So this is going to be equal to the square root of 1 take away p times 1 over 27. Or, in other words, you can rewrite it as 1 take away p over 27. Because anything times by a 27th basically means to divide it by 27. So we get this. Okay, well, now we know the sort of what f of a third is and g of a third is, we can set them equal to each other, because we are told in the question that they are equal to each other. So we can set these things equal to each other. So 2 thirds is equal to the square root of 1 take away p over 27. Now, how are we going to solve for p? Well, we need to get rid of everything that is attached onto that p. So first things first is to get rid of that square root. To get rid of a square root, you would square both sides of the equation. So you do 2 thirds squared, which is going to be 4 over 9, because you square the numerator, square the denominator, is equal to 1 take away p over 27. Because all we've done at this point is we've just kind of got rid of the square root. Now, you can actually add p over 27 to both sides. Now, why would you do that? Well, I don't like the idea that at the moment this is a negative p over 27. And obviously negatives are more difficult to deal with. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add p over 27 to both sides. Now, this step is optional. You can still solve the equation without doing this. I just think working with negatives can sometimes be a bit tricky. So this turns into p over 27 plus 4 ninths is equal to 1 by adding p over 27 to both sides. Okay, now then, p over 27 is equal to 1 take away 4 ninths. We're going to get rid of these 4 ninths by taking it away from both sides. So take it away from this side and then take it away from that side, and we get 5 over 9. 1 take away 4 ninths is 5 ninths. And now, to solve for p, we need to multiply both sides by 27 to get rid of that divide by 27. So we get 5 times 27, which is going to be 135 over 9. Now, I actually know that 135 divides by 9 because there's a little trick behind it. So you can actually do this division here. Now, because we don't have a calculator, let's use a quick bus stop division. So 0, 9's going to 1, carry 1 over. 1 remainder 4 and 5, so 15. So P is equal to 15, like that. Wowzers. So what a great question, but obviously a very kind of long question about sort of, do you understand how subbing into equations work, and can you solve an equation when it has things like square roots in it, fractions, negatives? That's kind of what this question is testing. How could we check our answer? Well, we could sub P is equal to 15 back into our original equations and double check that they that G of a third is equal to F of a third again. But I'm pretty happy that P is equal to 15 in this case. Okay then, let's have a look at question 11. A circle with center C touches the y-axis at point 0, 2, and the line y equals k intersects the circle at points 1k and 5k. Work out the equation of the circle. Now, a couple of observations to make then. Well, first of all, if you want to work out, the fact it says work out the equation of the circle implies that there is more than just looking at that circle and writing the answer. There's more than just that. It will have to take some kind of maths to work it out. Now, the equation of a circle is written in the form x take away a squared plus y take away b squared is equal to r squared, where a and b is the center and the r is the radius. Okay, so how we're gonna, so we need kind of two bits of information here. We need the center of the circle and we need the radius of the circle. Let's start with the radius first, because I think just by looking at this, that's gonna be slightly easier than the radius. Well, the center of the circle is here and they give us two points here. Now, if we were to draw a triangle in like this, now this step is not necessarily needed, but I think it kind of better explains where I'm going to get this answer from. So what I've drawn there is I've kind of drawn a triangle that links these two points with the center of the circle. Now, what is so interesting about this triangle? Well, because this is a radius and this is a radius, then this is an isosceles triangle. Right, these sides are the same length, which means that if I wanted to find the center of the circle, if I was to split this triangle in half like that, then because this triangle is isosceles, that distance there is halfway to that distance there. So if this has an x coordinate of 1 and this has an x coordinate of 5, then that means this point here has an x coordinate of 3, because it must be halfway between those two points, because we originally had an isosceles triangle that we split straight down the middle. So that means the center of the circle must also have x coordinate of 3, because it's in line with that coordinate. So it must also have x coordinate of 3. Okay, well, where is the y coordinate going to come from then? Well, that is the helpful information that we were told about this point here. We're told that it touches the circle here, okay, in line with the center, and this has y coordinate of 2. So that means the center must be in line with that y coordinate, so it also has y coordinate 2. So we know that the center of the circle is 3, 2. And so we can start writing our equation here as x take away 3 squared plus y take away 2 squared is equal to, now we just need r squared. Actually, I'll just write r squared for now, and I'll write the final answer on the line. Now we just need the radius. Well, the radius, if we know it goes from 0 here to 2, well, that radius there must be a distance of 3. Sorry, 0 to 3 must be a distance of 3. So therefore, r squared is 9. So we can just write the equation of the line as x take away 3 squared plus y take away 2 squared is equal to 9. which is 3 squared. So actually a really interesting question, this one, like surprisingly interesting question, because I don't think there's been many questions I've seen where they sort of use midpoints to find centers of circles to find the equations. I think that's quite a unique question. So yeah, if hopefully that's kind of offered a little bit of better clarity on this one, because I don't think it's necessarily the longest question in the world, but kind of just getting your head around how you actually find the center of the circle and therefore how you find the radius, that is probably the trickiest part of this question. Okay, let's have a look at the time. We'll probably squeeze in one more into this part, why not? So AB is equal to 4 centimeters, AC is equal to 7, cos of x is equal to -2/7. Work out the length BC. Well, because we've got two sides, let's call this angle A and sides B and C. Well, we can use cosine rule. Cosine rule says that A squared is equal to B squared plus C squared, take 2BC cos A. And because we have the angle between the two sides, we can use cosine rule to find this side. So that means that BC squared is equal to, well, B squared is going to be 4 squared plus 7 squared, take away 2 times 4 times 7 times cos of A, which in this case I'm going to scribble that out and write -2/7 instead. So we don't even have to work out what x is, what the angle is. We don't really care, to be honest, because we're already given what cos of x is. Now we just need to tidy this up. So BC squared is equal to 16 plus 49, take away 2 times 4 is 8 times 7 is 56, so take away 56 times -2/7. Okay, now we just need to tidy this up a little bit more. 16 plus 49 is 65. And then -56 times by a -2/7 is going to be a positive. 56 times 2 is 112 over 7, like that. And then will 112 divide by 7? I believe it will. So BC squared is equal to 65 plus, 84 is 12 times 7, 91 is 13 times 7, 98 is 14 times 7, 105 is 15, so it'd be 16. You could have just used bus stop instead of trying to count up in multiples like me. And then 65 plus 16 is equal to 81. Seems like it's all falling into place here. So because BC squared is equal to 81, then BC must be equal to the square root of 81, which is equal to 9. So BC is 9 in this case. Another really good question there, but kind of a surprise, really, just sort of a standard cosine rule in GCSE Further Maths, which is quite nice. Okay then, you know what, we'll squeeze this one in as well into the time, why not? Rearrange t is equal to 3w cubed plus a all over w cubed take 2. So we need to make w the subject of the formula. So first things first, we need to multiply by w cubed take 2 on both sides. Okay. Why are we doing that? Well, that's going to get rid of the divide by w cubed take away 2. So we get t brackets w cubed take away 2 is equal to 3w cubed plus a. And then we can expand these brackets, so we get tw cubed take away 2t is equal to 3w cubed plus a. Now let's get all the w terms onto the left hand side. So to do that, we need to get rid of this 2t, so we'll add 2t to both sides. I'm just going to put add 2t to both sides. So we get tw cubed is equal to 3w cubed plus a plus 2t. Then I'm going to take away 3w cubed from both sides because I want that to be on the left hand side. So I get tw cubed take away 3w cubed is equal to a plus 2t. Okay, now then, we can factorise out w cubed from these terms. So I get w cubed brackets t minus 3 is equal to a plus 2t. Then I can divide both sides by t take away 3. So I get w cubed. I'm dividing by this whole bracket, so that whole bracket disappears. And that is equal to a plus 2t over t take away 3. And then how am I going to get w on its own? Well, I'm going to cube root both sides. So I get w is equal to the cube root of a plus 2t over t take away 3. And that's my final answer. So w is equal to the cube root of a plus 2t over t take away 3. Like that. Wowzers. So I think I blasted through that quite quickly there, but hopefully that sort of makes some kind of sense. It's an absolute classic method, this, where you kind of multiply out, you get loads of terms, you get all the terms you want on the left hand side, you factorize out that term, you divide by everything else to get rid of it, so you're just left with that term that you want, and then you square root or cube root at the end to get it on its own. So it's quite a classic technique, this, to expand and then to factorize out the term that you want. Is quite a common way of rearranging formula. It's quite a difficult way of rearranging formula, but at a high level it tends to come up quite a bit. Okay, then we'll leave it there for those parts, and we'll start on question 14 in the next part, which is, as I can see, quite a nice rationalize the denominator question. So we'll leave it here for this part. I hope you found these questions useful. I've been actually receiving a lot of great positive feedback on other GCSE further maths questions and paper explanations on other videos. And I just want to thank those people for that, because I'm really glad it's helping you to revise for what is quite a difficult qualification. So hopefully it has helped, and hopefully that means that you can better understand some of the concepts in GCSE Further Maths. If you have any questions or concerns, then please feel free to drop them in the comments below, and I will try to get round to answering them. And definitely check out more videos if you haven't already. But I just want to thank you for watching, and I hope you have a fantastic day.